Hello, everyone. Welcome to our 8th annual Open Education Network Summit. We are so excited to have you join us over the course of this week. To start off, we welcome you to our very first session, the Summit Kickoff with Dave, Strategic Planning Action Pathways. My name is Barb Thies, and I am the Director of Community Engagement here at the OEN. We are delighted to have you all here today, and we thank you for the work that each of you in our community do to make education more equitable, accessible, and affordable through open education. Before we begin, the OEN is housed at the University of Minnesota Twin Cities, which is located on traditional, ancestral, and contemporary lands of Indigenous people. The university resides on Dakota land ceded in the treaties of 1837 and 1851. We acknowledge this place has a complex and layered history. This land acknowledgement is one of the ways in which we work to educate the campus and community about this land and our relationships with it and each other. We are committed to ongoing efforts to recognize, support, and advocate for American Indian nations and peoples. Please feel free to think about and acknowledge the Indigenous people to whom the land you are situated on belongs today and over the course of the week, if you feel so inclined. Dave and I will both be monitoring the Q&A today, and as we begin the session, we'd like to share a few important logistical details with you. This session is being recorded. For that reason, videos, transcripts, and slides will be sent to all of our attendees and to the OEN Google group after the summit has concluded. We'll also be posting video recordings on the Community Hub, so you can find them there afterwards. We've allotted a little bit of time at the end of today's session for questions. Please submit your questions, via the Q&A feature in Zoom. We may not have a chance to answer all of the submitted questions, but Dave will do his best to do so. We are committed to providing a friendly, safe, and welcoming environment for all attendees. You can learn more about our community norms at z.umn.edu/summitcommunitynorms. And please join us in creating a safe and constructive space this week. The hashtag for the summit is #OENSummit22. And you can join us on Twitter @OpenEd_network. And now please join me in welcoming our Executive Director, Dave Ernst.
Great, thank you so much, Barb. And welcome everyone. I'm Dave Ernst, I'm the Executive Director of the Open Education Network. And it's welcome. I'm so happy to see so many people here, so many familiar names, so many names I don't know. But this is the 8th annual OEN Summit, and these have always been important community meetings for us, you know, filled with conversation and information, and this year will be no different. I'm really looking forward to this week, and I hope you are as well. I'd like to give a special shout out to those of you who may be watching from watch parties that gathered to participate in Summit this week. I know it takes some effort to get people together, but what a great way to build community and have good discussions and have fun, especially after these last few years. This summit is a little different than past years in that it is structured around the results of our strategic planning process. This morning, I'm going to show you our ambitious strategic plan, at least I think it's ambitious. And then the sessions this week are structured to provide you more detail and opportunities for discussion and input on the strategic planning. And so it's I'll tie it all together at the end here. You'll see how the week kind of wraps into our strategic plan. But the strategic planning process for the OEN was kicked off just about this time last year, actually, almost a year ago. The OEN staff spent a lot of time over the last 12 months and a lot of energy engaged in strategic planning on top of doing the jobs that you know them doing in this community. And more than anything, you know, we want to be useful. We want what we do to be useful to this community. And so we really focused on listening to our members and hearing what you thought would be useful. We looked at data collected in our last community scan survey. We listened to our funder, our largest funder, the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. We engaged them in this with their kind of broader view of open education. We engaged our steering committee with drafts of the plan and really appreciated the feedback that they gave us about what we were planning. Then, as always, we also had a many, many focused discussions with community members, with many of you. And I really want to thank everyone who took the time to meet with us and just answer our many questions. You probably had much more of an impact than you know. We would go away from those conversations and it would really, really change and shape the direction we decided to go. So we really, really appreciate that. We couldn't do this without your input. But there's one thing that I think was clear that we all are aiming at. We're all working towards this educational equity through open education. No matter what your specific focus is in open education, no matter what your projects you have going on, it's about educational equity, right? Whether it's affordability or bringing new voices into higher education, this is what's kept me working in this field for these years. It's the passion, the energy, and the commitment that all of you bring to advancing equity at your institutions and in your organizations and across your states and for the whole field. You're impacting the whole field, many of you. And so this was our focus during our strategic planning. The question we continually asked ourselves was, you know, how can we support higher education champions like yourselves to advance educational equity? We also kept in mind our OEN guiding principles, and they were developed by this community a few years ago, and they've been incredibly important in defining who we are. The more thinking and talking that we did about our strategic planning, the more I realized how important these were and that these were values and principles that kind of held us together and made us who we are, make us who we are. So it really helped us stay focused on who we are during the planning. I'd like to highlight one of the principles here that I'm going to come back to later today. And it's the last one there, shared abundance. The belief that together as a whole community, we have what it takes to solve some important problems. So I'll be talking about that one later, and we'll actually have a separate session focused on that, on shared abundance later today at 2:30 Central. So before I get into the plan, I wanna just briefly remind you of what we do already as a community. This is what some of the things that we do as a network. We connect people. That's the most important thing that we do. We're a network. We connect people. We run professional development programs. We run infrastructure. We have best practices we provide and materials and strategies overall, like and how to make change. And so I'm going to just quickly remind you of a few of the things that we already do so you can see how our planning fits into that, where we already are and what we already do. So the first thing we do is this connecting people. It's, again, the most important thing that we can do together as a community is connect with one another. We are one large community, the OEN, but within our large community, there are other smaller communities. For example, NICE. NICE standing for, this is really creative, Nourishing Interconsortial Collaborative Excellence. So that's a group of system and consortial leaders who are running open education programs across consortia or systems. And we have a very vibrant group of people having important discussions about the common things that they're seeing together as system or consortial leaders. The colleague connector. The colleague connector is a program that pairs kind of one-on-one professionals with one another to share ideas and just have meaningful conversations that support or enhance your open education initiatives. That is something that right now is open for this kind of, we've had, that's that existed for 1 year. The second year is just launching and the application is still open. And if somebody has the link, there we go. Thank you, Barb. Barb dropped the link in. If you're interested in joining that or applying to the Connector program, please do. Then there is also the publishing cooperative or the co-op. Members who complete Pub 101, which we'll talk about here in a minute, are invited to join the publishing cooperative. And that's just a community of people who want to continue to learn and talk more about publishing open textbooks. So you can see these are a few of the programs that we run that connect people who have some common interests and can benefit from talking with one another. We also run a number of, and a growing number of, professional development programs. I want to just throw out some numbers here because this is probably the place that the work that we've been doing the longest. The faculty workshop, that faculty workshop that was developed, you know, almost probably 8-10 years ago, to our best estimate, is has probably been given just about 1,000 times. We no longer have a clear idea because many of you are running these workshops, so we may or may not know about them anymore, but that's our best estimate. It's been over 1,000 times. We have train-the-trainer workshops, which are basically working with librarians or other open education professionals and helping them start or enhance their open education programs. And we've trained over 2,300 professionals in that train-the-trainer program. We had partner workshops that we haven't given in a while. That was when we used to do campus visits more directly. We don't really know how many partners we trained. But again, my best guess is about 1,000 or so. We have a senior leader seminar that we use to train leaders across the Midwest in multiple states. We've trained 155 senior leaders. And by that, we're talking about provosts, presidents, deans, department chairs, directors of teaching offices of teaching and learning, and so on. And we've had 521 people register for Pub 101. So we run a lot of professional development programs, and this is only growing, as you see. The certificate in OER librarianship has now gone through. It's finished its fourth year. It's in its fourth year here. And it's an 8-week-long online course. It has a monthly mentor-led cohort meetings, and then it has program development support after that's all wrapped up. So there's a culminating final project that helps participants put what they learned into action. And so we've had 220 participants in this, again, with our eye on educational equity. We want to make sure we're benefiting everyone as much as possible. We're bringing new voices in. We have full scholarships for BIPOC librarians. We've had 15 of those over the 4 years. And we also have a partial scholarship for resource poor institutions. And we've had a number of those over the years. There's a new certificate program that's being developed as we speak. And this is an Institute of Museum and Library Services grant that was received by Roger Williams University and North Carolina State University. And they partnered with us to create this. And this is also open for applications right now and will be offered in this coming year. There's infrastructure that we've been supporting. The number one piece of infrastructure is the Open Textbook Library. As you may know, it turned 10 years old this year. It's got over 1,000 books. I think we're at 1,050 something last time I looked. Continues to be an incredibly important piece of infrastructure that's out there benefiting everybody. No membership involved. It's a public resource. We have the Community Hub, which is a place where we organize all of our best practices and documents and slide decks and videos and anything that resources that we have that you as a member can access. And in addition to that, we have the data dashboard that also is a tool for you to use to manage your open education programs. So again, I didn't want to dip into any of those too much, But I just wanted to get a reminder of all the things we're already doing. And as we look forward, what we used to build out our strategic plan was we were reminded by a few members to look to see what we already do and do well and build on that. And I thought that was really, really good advice. So I got a table here that's kind of summarize, I think, our strategic initiatives are going to move forward into. And so you're going to see some familiar structure here, because I'm going to first outline some programs that we already do in this structure. But so the vision that we have, of course, as I talked about earlier, that we all have as a community is educational equity. And our mission as the OEN is to support you and for you to support each other, right? It's, in other words, you're receiving some support to develop and run local programs to do what? Well, the one that we've been running for quite a while is to develop local programs in OER adoptions, right? To help you help your faculty learn about and hopefully eventually act on adoptions of open resources. And so you can see the structure of this, of these programs, of this program. We have, what we try to do is break out the program into its component parts. We have materials, we have member training, we have faculty engagement strategies. In other words, how to get faculty to act and then support that action. We have infrastructure, could be technical infrastructure or whatever. We have, and then we have staffing. So for our example here of OER adoptions, we have in materials, we have the workshop slides that any of you can access and use and change and edit however you like. We have a workshop video, a demonstration video, so that you can see how it, an example of how it's given. We have dashboard support materials so that you can use the dashboard to support these adoption programs. For training, we have Train the Trainer workshop that I've already mentioned. We have the dashboard training that Barb has given a number of times for folks to learn how to use the dashboard. We have faculty engagement strategies, which is the faculty workshop, including writing a textbook and so on. That's a strategy of getting action to take place and ways to support the faculty. We have infrastructure, which I mentioned earlier. We have the open textbook library. We have the data dashboard. And we have staffing. We have people. We have trainers who run these workshops. When we were traveling to campuses, we had probably at least a dozen different trainers who would, from the community, who would we would hire to go out and run these workshops. And so it takes all of these pieces to run a program like this, right? Here's another example of something that we already do. We run the Open Textbook Publishing Program. We support you, as he says on the top there, we support you to develop local programs in open textbook publishing. So there, we'll start with materials. We have Pub 101 course materials that are openly licensed and out there. We have Pub 101 itself, which is a group of people walking through that curriculum and supporting one another in it. We have the Publishing Cooperative, which again is a community of people who want to continue talking about it. We have best practice documents. We have documents about editing and authoring and so on. We have, for infrastructure, we have Pressbooks has always kind of honored OEN membership and giving people discounts in their services. And we've also had a partnership with Scribe, which is a more of a professional publishing services that are available that have been great partners to us and to others who have tried publishing textbooks. So that's another pathway there of that. So I'm calling each of these a pathway. Notice that's another pathway that we can support. But what we'd like to do, when you notice there's two columns in the middle, the one on the left is probably the one that takes the least investment of time, investment of money. It takes time, takes money, takes energy, takes a lot of things, but it's on the spectrum here, it's probably the least. Publishing a textbook probably falls in the most. Publishing textbooks is anyone who has supported those kind of projects are very expensive time-wise, resource-wise. So there's two pathways here in the middle that I want to talk about that we want to move into and help support you in your work. And one is open pedagogy. These are going to be obvious, by the way. These are things that if you understand open education and what the possibilities are, you'll know what these are going to be. But open pedagogy is one. And so some examples of the kinds of things that we're going to be developing would be materials, faculty workshop slides. Why open pedagogy? Kind of very similar to the faculty workshop slides for adoption, which is really all about adoption. You can see other materials that might be created about, you know, paying attention to student intellectual property and equity in open education, and maybe showcasing projects that are already out there. Member training, we'll want to make sure we put together some training for you. And if we go down to the faculty engagement strategy, you can see that the engagement strategy that we're going to choose for this are learning circles. Open pedagogy is fairly pedagogy is complex and it's very human and very different depending on each instructor and it takes discussion. It's one of these things that I think is best supported through just being able to share what's going on and how things are going. And so learning circles are the structure for that we're going to be supporting. And so if you go back up to the member training, we will make sure we're going to create a leadership training so that you will know how to run a learning circle locally at your institutions to support open pedagogy. So that's new pathway number one. New pathway number two is we want to create programming to support you to develop local programs in OER revision and collection. And I would say this is the one that's probably least fleshed out at this point. We still have some work to do on this, but again, we can create an introductory faculty workshop slides like why revise OER, why make a collection of OER. And again, I put a TBD there and then faculty engagement strategies because there may be other strategies that we find or you tell us you want that may be more effective. And then we can provide some training to flesh that out and to make sure everyone has access to that. So those are the two new pathways. But you'll notice there are more rows here that are blank. And so this is one of the biggest changes and biggest investments I think we're going to make here is we want to support the infrastructure to do this work. And let me tell you why. I guess, you know, when I'd run faculty workshops and we tell them about open pedagogy, for example, say, oh, here's something you can do. You can engage your students in creation and you can leverage open materials for that and so on. Inevitably, there'd be a hand that goes up and a faculty member will ask, that sounds great. How do I do that? And the question has that, it's like, I always have to say, oh, that's a great question. Talk to your local librarian or instructional designer or whoever, your local support people. Maybe they can help you use the infrastructure you have to do it. Or maybe there really were no kind of best practices laid out. There was no infrastructure that was identified that, oh, well, you could use this infrastructure and here's how you do it. So what we'd like to do is we'd like to provide a platforms. And we'd like to provide these platforms with support tied in. So not only will we say support open pedagogy and Pressbooks, Manifold, Editoria, and so on, but we'll then provide documentation and training on that platform to you so that you could then support that work with your own faculty if you choose to or find the resources to do that. And you notice that I kind of made that platform row stretch across all three of these pathways. Some of those technologies and infrastructure might be more useful for one pathway more than another. but generally we're still figuring that out. You probably know right now we have a manifold pilot and we have people working in manifold. You can hear from them later this week. And part of what they have committed to is that they're going to help us learn what manifold is good for. We think it might be good for making collections, for example. We're trying to figure out how it might be good for open pedagogy. And once we figure that out, we'll be able to use that knowledge to help you then create trainings and materials and so on. So again, Manifold is probably the pilot, the one that you have heard about in our community, because we have a pilot right now, thanks to a grant from the Manifold folks that gave us kind of free access and training and support to Manifold for a year. And then we've committed to another year as well of the pilot so that people have time to build their pilot projects in this. Editoria is one you might not be aware of, but I have really, I don't know, I'm optimistic about Editoria. Editoria is a web-based book production platform. It's an open source project built by the COCO Foundation. And the COCO Foundation, COCO is short for Collaborative Knowledge Foundation. They have been wonderful partners to work with. Again, it's a book production platform. And then about 3 years ago, I received an IMLS, an Institute of Museum and Library Services grant to build a tool connected to Editoria to help authors plan and structure their textbooks. And this textbook builder, the Open Textbook Builder, again, funded by IMLS, is just about done. The grant wraps up in about a month. The actual work on the textbook builder is almost complete. There's a demo that is part of the summit scheduled for Wednesday of this week. So look for that on the schedule. I'm really excited about it. And structuring this work of writing textbooks has been the biggest complaint of authors, is their need to structure it pedagogically, structure it technically, structure it style-wise, structure it. So we're going to help them structure it and then fit all those pieces into it. Anyway, you'll see the demo hopefully later this week. So that is, so far, that's our strategic planning. But you'll notice there's one more row there. And we decided that this isn't going to be feasible if it's just kind of lumped up into the work that we already do. We need more people on the ground doing this work. And so we will soon be posting a position for an open educational practices specialist. And this would be someone who's looking at this infrastructure and creating that documentation and some of that training so that we can help faculty say, you want to do open pedagogy, here's some options, here's how you can try doing it. Here, you know, and of course, we're not going to come up, be able to document and train on every possible way you can do open pedagogy. It's not possible. But at least we can give some starting points and some places that people, some structure and knowledge so that people can get started a little bit easier, that it's a little bit less of a lift. The other thing then we're going to do is hire a fellow then to help develop and implement Learning Circle curriculums and curriculum and training so that we get that piece of it built and can start those kinds of trainings for you. So that is 90% of our strategic plan right there summarized in this little table. We want to add two new pathways. So we're adding vertically here, but we're also adding quite a bit horizontally. We're adding new pieces to each of these pathways as they exist, including infrastructure and including people to help support that. You'll notice there's one more row there. And this one is kind of special, not well developed at this point, but as a team, we decided that this was critical. And it's because, again, here's our focus, educational equity, right? if this diagram represents the OEM, so each of these circles is, I know I used it for something else earlier, but I'm reusing it now. Imagine each of these circles is an organization. Each of these is an institution, a college or a university. And you can see there are many different types of universities. There's small, there's large, there's public, there's private, there's research, there's community college, there's tribal college, HBCU, and so on. They all have one thing in common. These are OEM member institutions. They probably have one thing in common, and that's they probably have a person or people who are supporting open education. They probably, not all of them, but most of them, have a budget for open education support, evidenced by the fact that they paid an OEM community fee, right? They're members of the OEM. They must have some funding there. This is good, by the way. This is what institutions should have, people and should have budgets supporting open education. That's what we want. That's in some ways the end game. Let's keep working on this as institutions and organizations. But I also want to point out that there are many institutions out there that don't have that kind of funding or staffing. They might have one librarian for the whole school with a very, very limited budget. The faculty in these institutions might not ever hear about open ed, or if they do, they won't be able to get any significant support or training or funding to change their practice. This is a generalization, of course. I do want to keep mentioning that. There are OEM members who have little or no budget and time, and there are non-OEM members who do. But as a generality, generally speaking, there's a tendency for this to be true. There are just lots of organizations out there that don't have resources. So our team asked this question. As we were going through the strategic planning, we always kept this in mind. Are there ways that we as a community can support these institutions and their faculty, these ones in the shadows here, so we're not just widening the gap between the haves and have-nots? We don't want open education to become another one of those things that's just making more haves and have-nots, just widening the gap between institutions, between faculty and students. So how can we benefit as a community, all of these institutions? And that's a tough question. We also have, all of us, whether we're OEM members or not, have people in our institutions, subsets of students, who aren't well represented in their course materials. And we know for a fact that that makes a difference in their education. So if our real goal is educational equity, then we have to keep this in mind too. There are perspectives that are ignored, which effectively means that some of our students are ignored. So another question that our team asked was, are there ways that we can support a balancing of representation and perspectives in course materials? Or again, is open education just going to be another tool that continues to kind of, that continues to widen the gap, right, between groups of people? So when we looked at this, we made sure to keep in mind in every pathway this last piece. Those important questions. We want those cannot be forgotten. And so this is where I said I'm going to bring you back, but let me back up a second. We don't know the answers to those questions. How do we do those things? We don't know. As you can see by everything I've listed today, the OEN staff have a lot to do. Much will be added to their plates in the coming months, because you can see what's going to be fleshed out here. So how is it possible that, along with supporting OEM members' work in all of these areas, that the staff could also support faculty in schools that don't have their own support, or take the task of promoting representation and perspective in course materials that are created everywhere? We came to the conclusion that they can't. We can't as a small staff, and no matter how much they tried or how much they want to. But we wanted to take a look at this from a different perspective. We wanted to take a look at this from a community perspective. I told you earlier I'd come back to this share abundance principle earlier. And so the question we're asking has changed a little bit to be, can the OEM community as a whole help those faculty who have no support or help advance underrepresented perspectives and course materials? Shared abundance. So that last row in each of these pathways is the shared abundance row. And this row is empty right now. This row is empty because we need your ideas and we need your thoughts. We want to spend some time brainstorming about we as a larger community, what we can do as a larger community. And I also don't want to imply that any one person in our community feels that they have an abundance of anything. More often than not, people would say they certainly don't have an abundance of budget or time or et cetera. So, but I'd be interested to brainstorm about this and think of if we access some real, if we access some real creative thinking here, I think we could think about how we can have a larger impact on higher education together. Again, I don't have answers to this, but that's the hope. This is our schedule for the week, and I wanted to point to a couple different, and here's what I said earlier. I said that the week is structured around our strategic planning that we did and the kind of what we're coming out of with it. You can see the afternoon today at 2:30 p.m. Central Time is reserved to brainstorm about the community about action pathways and shared abundance. It's titled Community Conversation, Action Pathways and Shared Abundance. And so I hope you come to that and add your voice and express some creative ideas about how we can make a larger impact. This community has grown and continues to grow and grow. And so I think the opportunity for our shared abundance benefiting all of higher education continues to grow as well. I think the possibilities are there. You can see then, I color coded them, but you can see how each day kind of aligns with a different strategic planning pathway, right? From this, we have adoptions, open pedagogy, revisions, collections, and publishing. Tomorrow is going to be focused largely on open pedagogy and kind of the social justice pieces that fit into open pedagogy that structure it. Wednesday is revision and collection and publishing, textbook publishing. Those are the days that if you want interested in seeing that infrastructure in Manifold or Editoria, the textbook builder tool connected to Editoria, those are be demonstrated. That day. And then Thursday is focused on adoptions, a revised faculty workshop. And then we're also going to talk about, this is another brainstorming topic in the afternoon on Thursday, where we want to talk about, along with some of our steering committee members, we want to talk about the possibility of leveraging our community data to have a broader impact on the field, support you, and maybe support institutions that aren't even OEM members. So that's another kind of brainstorming one that I hope you show up for. And then we kind of wrap it all up and have a debrief on Friday. So I hope that I've been clear here. I try to make this as much of a summary as possible. So it's not getting into the nitty gritty of the strategic planning. It was a year long. It took a lot of energy and time. But I think what we came out with is promising. I'm really excited about it, and I hope you are too. Please engage in the week. Again, if you want to find out more about these pathways, this is the week to do it. Go to those sessions each of those days. Look at what's being offered for the things that you're interested in learning more about or think you can contribute to. And we will move forward. I want to end on the most important note, which is that the OEN is you. The OEN is a community of people just like you who are trying to do this work, trying to figure it out. And we can accomplish much more together, right, than we can on our own. I want to remind you that this session, if you want to go back for whatever reason and look at it, it will be recorded and it'll be shared with you via email, and it'll be posted in the community hub with everything else in the coming weeks. It might take a little bit of a time, but the slides and the transcripts will be linked in there as well. So thank you all again for joining the session. And now we have lots of time for questions if you have any. You can just put them into the Q&A. We have one question in there already, although it's not really a question. Stephen Bell. Hi, Stephen. He said, looking forward to the Editoria demo. In addition to being a platform for OER textbook authoring, it is designed to be easy for others to modify the books created with Editoria. Yes, absolutely right. I think that's what's so exciting about Editoria, is that it's everything's in one place. Potentially the authoring, the structuring, the editing, the publishing, in other words, the output of it. It's built to do all of those things all in one place, which is really interesting. And it's completely open source. And the people behind it are as committed to open as we are, I'm convinced. They've been great partners, the Collaborative Knowledge Foundation. Do you anticipate you'll be looking for the Open Pedagogy and Learning Circle Fellows? I think it will be soon. Tanya, any guess on that? I'm going to put you on the spot.
As soon as I can possibly get it out there. So yes, Dave, you're right. Very soon. I'm very excited to get that search underway.
Yep. Great. Thank you. Stephen Kruger asks, has there been a shift/increase in the types of institutions joining the OEN over time, more private schools than previously, I hope? Good question. Barb, feel free to chime in on this if you happen to know the answer. But I can tell you from early days, they were mostly research institutions, right? It started in Minnesota, then I think it was like Purdue, then maybe Oregon State, Arizona, Oklahoma. And a lot of that is just what happens in higher ed. It's that peer pressure. Minnesota's doing it. Purdue better do it. Or, you know. But eventually we started to see more college, like four-year college, not necessarily research, systems join and consortia join and consortia of community colleges join. There are whole states of private institutions who've joined. So your question about privates, but I would say that's still a space that is where maybe there's an opportunity. Barb, do you have anything you want to add to that? It's a good question, Stephen. I don't know that I know the answer to that really in detail about how our membership has changed. It has. I feel like it's filled in quite a bit. Where community colleges have joined. There've been more of them. There've been more state systems. All the tribal colleges in the country joined last year with the leadership of the American Indian Higher Education Consortium. So, hi Marilyn, I owe you an email. I think Marilyn. Granting entities such as the U.S. Department of Education are providing grants for the development, the adaptation, the adoption of open ed materials with an equity lens. Here in Massachusetts, we have one of these grants where we are creating and adopting existing OER. There are also other OEN members who are engaged in this work. Absolutely. And that's one of the reasons that we really felt that it was important to start. We'd like to see that spread from leaders like yourselves. There are also any thoughts on mutual work with the Department of Education to accomplish the Educational Equity Strategic Plan or more holistic national plan? Marilyn, if you can set up that meeting, we'd love to have it. Absolutely. Anything that we can do, any organization that we can collaborate with that has that same vision Absolutely. We want to be there with them. So thank you, Marilyn. Other questions? Left lots and lots of time here. I'm going to bring this back up here. So nothing else? Okay. Hey, Amanda. Amanda asks, do you expect to invite community involvement in new initiatives via committees, et cetera? Yes, absolutely, especially the shared abundance pieces. And I think we have learned, Karen has run a really nice kind of community controlled model in the Pub 101 training and fleshing that out. And so we'd like to, I think ideally we'd like to see that involvement across all of these. I think we all benefit when we do this together. So yes, Amanda. And Amy, hi, Amy. She makes a comment. Thanks for the excellent update. And it's exciting to see. Oh, well, the Orion is heading. Well, thank you. And we honestly, we is us, right? We're all together in this. We're going there together. We as a community have to do this together, or we're the five of us here are powerless to do anything. So thanks for your leadership, Amy. Anything else? Okay, well, I was a junior high school teacher. I used to be really good at wait time, making people uncomfortable till they ask a question. But I think I've waited long enough. So with that, please have a great week. Get involved. Speak up if you have ideas, you have thoughts, especially I would say this afternoon session. The whole point of it is to be brainstorming. And also the one on Thursday about data sharing is meant to be a brainstorming discussion. So sorry, I'm reading another question. Marilyn, how about more work with national accrediting agencies beyond? Absolutely, would love that too, beyond the compacts, yes. So anyway, please get involved. Let us know if there's anything you need, and thank you for attending. See you later this week.